नमस्कार टू एवरीबडी। आरंभे कतिपय वाक्यानि संस्कृत भाषया उक्त्वा पश्चात् आंग्ल भाषायां अहं प्रवचनं करिष्ये। अस्मिन् दिने तावत् आरंभे एव मह्यं सूचना दत्ता यत् अत्र आगताः बहवः संस्कृतं सम्यक् न जानन्ति, तस्मात् संस्कृत भाषायाः विषये किञ्चित् एवञ्च कालिदासस्य विषये परिचयात्मकं किञ्चित् उक्त्वा पश्चात् विषयमम् अधिकृत्य प्रवचनं क्रियताम् इति आरम्भे एव सूचना दत्ता। तदनुरोधेन अहम् आङ्ग्लभाषायां प्रवचनं करोमि। आरम्भे किञ्चित् एतान् विषयान् स्पृष्ट्वा पश्चात् विवृणोमि। इट् गिव्स् मी ग्रेट् प्लेजर् टु बी हियर् इन् युर् मिड्स्ट् टु स्पीक् आन् दि पोयट्री आफ् Kalidasa. Way back in 1920 or so, Ananda Kumara Swami made this remark that you go and ask any graduate of India, he will be eager to show off his knowledge of Shakespeare. Ask him to speak a few words about Kalidasa. He knows next to nothing except his name. This was the situation that Ananda Kumara Swami grieved about way back in 1920. The situation must obviously be very worse. The Britishers devised a wonderful plan of cutting off the entire country from its heritage, because the sap juice that was running through this eternal tree was Sanskrit. And once that the flow of that is cut off, the whole civilization can be made bereft of its roots. So they devised that master plan, and that is how we have been studying Sanskrit through English or some regional language and so on, and not paying attention to Sanskrit. And it's a great tragedy that we Indians have ourselves forgotten Sanskrit. And the irony of the situation also is that Westerners now have mastered Sanskrit. There are quite a few scholars in America and Europe who have mastered Sanskrit. They have been studying Sanskrit for something like two centuries, and the amount of output pertaining to Sanskrit that they have been making is enormous and mind-boggling. But all of that, you must note, that is bereft of the right attitude that is required for the study of Sanskrit, and therefore a good deal of it is highly prejudiced. And regarding one of the giants today by name Sheldon Pollock, I have produced some 3-4 volumes already showing the flaws in their thinking, in their very approach, and their systematic efforts to distort. So this is an age of mainly of misinformation and disinformation, and that way we are being projected as a very ugly civilization by the Westerners. So a corrective measure has to start somewhere, and this is one small effort in the direction. The chair, Sant Rajinder Singh Ji Maharaj chair, has been instituted to inculcate in this campus an atmosphere that speaks of the spiritual heritage of our country and the scientific aspects of the heritage and so on. And the attempt that we make in this series, Kalidasa is known as a Shringara Kavi, a poet who portrays the sentiment of love very well. But that is only one aspect of it. As we will show in the subsequent talks, he is well grounded in the Indian tradition, and the dharmic and spiritual values in his works are extraordinary. Okay, it is only the lay who read Kalidasa read only looking for the Shringara aspects of it. Shringara is an integral part of life, but that is not the only part of it. And in fact, Shringara itself, taken to its deep levels, touches the spiritual, which is why if you look into the Upanishads, if they have to give an analogy for the experience of spiritual bliss, they have to borrow ideas from Shringara field only. So, Ithahi Preya Bhareya Samprashyuktaha Nantaram Vedana Bahyam, says the Upanishad. So, the Upanishads too have to give give this as the very example. And thus, in fact, even Anandavardhana says, Shringara eva paramaha prahladano rasaha. So that is the importance of Shringara rasa, and that is also the reason why Kalidasa laid stress on that. There are also other aspects like the importance of this in the Pratyabhijna school in Kashmir Shaivism. So that context also obtains here, but we will go into those details much later. The Sanskrit language has been held in high regard in our tradition. There is the famous saying, Bhashasu Divya Madhura Mukhya Madhura Divya Girvana Bharati. So this is the most important language and is very sweet language, and it is also a very scientific language, and it has also been conferred the status of a divine language. This is one aspect of it. And most of the Indian languages borrow heavily from Sanskrit, and it is not merely Indian languages. If you look into Greek and Latin and German and French, and even Russian, okay, you can find the abundance of slight deformations of Sanskrit words. So as regards the history of the study of languages and so on, we find that everywhere they have to start with Indo-European. Even if they call it Indo-European, they have to start with Indo only. So there is a saying in Latin, ex oriente lux. So lux means light. So oriente is the east. It is from the east that light arises. So all light, all knowledge arises from the east. This is the meaning of that statement. So Bhartrihari said in his Vakyapadiya, Daivi Vag Vyavakirneyam Ashaktair Abhidhatribhihi. So this is the Daivi Vak, and because speakers could not pronounce it properly, they have made some distortions, and that is how most of our languages have Sanskrit words in a slightly altered form. So this is the greatness of this language. And the introduction of Sanskrit to the West was made primarily by Sir William Jones, who, upon seeing this language and studying some of its literature, made this very famous remark, namely, that this language is of wonderful structure, more perfect than Greek, more copious than Latin, and exquisitely refined than either. More exquisitely refined than either. So this is the statement of Sir William Jones. His date is 1746 to 1794. And if you want to know the contribution of India to knowledge, especially it was in the field of the study of language and the study of mind. So there is one article by M.B. Emeno of Berkeley. The title of the article is India and Linguistics. Please make it a point to go home and check from your JSTOR this article called India and Linguistics. It's a wonderful article. It brings out the excellent achievements of India as regards the study of language. So it is possible, it's more easily possible to make strides in the what are called the exact sciences or the hard sciences, like say chemistry, because to objectivize is rather easy. It is the subtle sciences that are very difficult. The science of language and the science of mind are not very easy to study, not easy to make progress in. But it is precisely in these two that India made extraordinary progress. And we can see the great names of Panini and Patanjali. So even to this day, see, it is only recently that Westerners, and more particularly scientists, that have been able to realize what a complex phenomenon language is. Now, thousands of engineers are involved in the projects of natural language processing in artificial intelligence, and some of the best theories that they have been able to arrive at have been already anticipated in Panini of the 5th century BC. So that will be a sufficient explanation for the great achievements of India in the field of language. And as regards the study of mind, you can see that yoga today has become a multi-billion dollar business, and it has to do essentially with the study of mind. The first statement of Yoga Sutra is Yogaha Chitta Vritti Nirodhaha. So it starts with that, and some of the greatest achievements have been made there also. And in a sense, Sanskrit is the only truly national language of India. You can see that there are a dozen languages in our country, all in certain pockets. But if there is one language for which, see, there has been contributions from every part of India, it is Sanskrit and Sanskrit alone. So from every corner, we find contributions to the literature of Sanskrit. And two works that can indeed be called the national epics are the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. And it is these two epics that describe the entire country. And it is in this context that you can see that the true national poet is Kalidasa indeed. We speak of Rabindranath Tagore as a national poet, or sometimes some poets like Kuvempu of Karnataka as a national poet and so on. There are some half a dozen national poets that we list. But if you look into Tagore, you can see that critics have remarked that Tagore makes a beautiful, exquisite description of the people of Bengal, very lifelike and very realistic description of the people there. And if you try to look for other regions of India, so you find hardly much. But it is only in the works of Kalidasa that you find the description of India and even their lifestyles, see, from Kashmir to Kerala and from Assam to almost up to Iran. Okay, his India extends to much beyond Afghanistan. Thus we find that it is in Kalidasa that we find a total national conception, and that way truly Kalidasa can be called the true national poet of our country. And in his Meghaduta, see, he loves even the geography of the country. In his Meghaduta, he gives a beautiful description from the middle part of India, from somewhere near Nasik, so that Ramtek mountain, to Manasa Sarovara, to Lake Manasa. He gives a description of the way, the route, the very route. So unless a person had a first-hand knowledge of this, so he would not have been able to do it. And in his Raghuvamsa, he once again gives, see, on two occasions, so he describes even the geography of India so very well. One in the context of Raghu's Digvijaya, he starts from the east, comes south, goes west, goes north, and then comes back to his capital. So there is a beautiful description of India, so the entire country. And another occasion in Kalidasa's Raghuvamsa is where Rama brings Sita from Lanka, where from Lanka to Ayodhya, you get a beautiful description of the country. So whatever had been left out in the other portions have all been covered here. And there are many competitors for claiming Kalidasa as their poet. You ask Kashmiris, they say Kalidasa belongs to Kashmir because he is the only poet who has been able to give a first-hand description of the saffron flower. Okay, and some of the practices there in Kashmir, they are all described and documented in Kalidasa. Okay, people from Calcutta and from Bengal and Orissa claim that he must have been from those regions. From people from Ujjain would say that no, Kalidasa belongs to our region. So he endears himself to everyone by giving authentic descriptions of the regions and the lifestyles and practices there. And this way also he is a true national poet. And imagine his knowledge of Indian geography in those ancient times. There have been different theories regarding the time of Kalidasa. So two theories are that one that he belonged to 1st century BC and the other attributing 5th century AD as his date. But there are more proofs that he belongs to the 1st century BC. And in those days when there were no modes of transport as we have today, so whether the aeroplane or the train, so when these were not there, how Kalidasa came to acquire such an intimate knowledge of the different regions of the country is something remarkable, and which we do not find even in the so-called national poets of today, persons like Rabindranath Tagore. So I'm not decrying or bringing down the other merits of the great poet Tagore, but this is one aspect that we find that it is preeminently found in Kalidasa. Thus, the true national poets of India are all, you see, ones who belong to the pre-Christian era. Valmiki, Vyasa and Kalidasa all have authentic descriptions of every region of the country, and it is only the later poets that are confined to their own regions. Kalidasa has also been called the Shakespeare of India by Westerners, because the greatest figure, literary figure that they could think of was Shakespeare, and therefore they gave this appellation of Shakespeare of India to Kalidasa. And if you look into the variety of literary works that he has produced, Shakespeare is known for producing dramas. Shakespeare has not written epic poetry, nor has he written lyrics. Of course, he has written numerous sonnets, but you don't find epic poetry written by Kalidasa, as for example has been written by Milton. So he has written Paradise Lost and Paradise Regained, but he has not written any drama. And Keats and Wordsworth, Shelley have written wonderful lyrics, but they have not written dramas, or they are not famous for epic poetry. But it is in Kalidasa that we find a grand blend of all these. So namely drama, he has written three dramas, namely Abhijnan Shakuntala, the best of his plays, and Malavikagnimitram and Vikramorushiyam. So these three plays have been written. He has written two epics, one is Raghuvamsha, another is Kumar Sambhava, and he has written two Khandakavyas or lyrics called Ritusamhara and Meghadoota or Meghasandesha. So in every department of literature, Kalidasa excels. That is why in our own country, Kalidasa has been given such a high position that it is said that once somebody began to count the number of poets, true poets, great poets, and it is said that after counting one finger, okay, they could not name a second who would rank equal to him. It's not that the number of poets is less. The vastness of literature produced in India is simply unparalleled. It's not a mere boast. This has been claimed by Sheldon Pollack himself, who says that next only to the English language that has produced vast amount of literature in the recent times, till English came to prominence, the one language that produced the greatest amount of literature is Sanskrit. And for your information, the number of manuscripts that have yet been not published in Sanskrit, so it comes to something like 30 million manuscripts which have not seen the light of day even once. So many manuscripts are lying. This in spite of the burning of libraries as of, see, Nalanda and Takshashila and so on by the invaders. So in spite of that, still there are so many manuscripts that are pending to be published. So if you want details about this, you can go to the website of NAMAMI or National Manuscript Mission, which is a part of IGNCA, Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts. So they can get some details there. So the famous poem, and the amount of literature that is produced in Sanskrit, even as regards poetry, leave alone other works. So there are thousands and thousands of poets, among whom all Kalidasa excels, which is why it is said, Pura Kavinam Ganana Prasange Kanishtika Adhishtita Kalidasa Adhyapi Tatulya Kaverabhava Anamika Sarthavati Babhuva. This finger is called Anamika. So Anamika means nameless. Okay, that is the name that is being given to this. It says, the verse says, Pura Kavinam Ganana Prasange. They began to count the number of poets. So Kanishtika Adhishtita Kalidasa. We start counting like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. So here Kalidasa ranked first. Adhyapi Tatulya Kaver Abhavat. Even to this day, there is no poet who can equal him. And therefore, this name, the name of this finger, namely Anamika, remains very true to its name. So Anamika Sarthavati Babhuva, so it is said. And therefore, he has been given the highest position in our own country. And Ashwaghosha is one poet who comes close to Kalidasa, but his date is 78 AD, and he wrote the Buddha Charita. And you find that in numerous places he has imitated Kalidasa, and you can find the inferiority of his poetry. So in his greater attention to Shabda Chamatkara, which is considered inferior. Okay, Kalidasa too indulges in Shabda Chamatkara in only one sarga, to just to show that he can do that. So he can excel in playing on words and so on. So, but that is not a poetry which is very enjoyable, but that shows the skill of the poet, his command over the language, command over the meters and so on. But he has confined it to one sarga in Raghuvamsa, the 9th canto, and nowhere else he indulges in that. So Kalidasa is prior to Ashwaghosha, that we will get to know while we study the 3rd canto of Kumarasambhavam. We will get to know that Kalidasa is essentially a poet of nature, and he writes in a very simple and graceful style. If you look into the writings of other poets, you will find the constructions very involved, and a very deep and strong knowledge of Sanskrit is required to understand them. But Kalidasa's poetry is utterly simple, and he is also most famous for his similes. So Upama Kalidasasya, they say, and most of the similes are drawn from nature. He was such a votary of nature, and his work abounds in metaphors and poetic fancies that we come across in his poetry. Great words of praise have been showered on Kalidasa. I can cite from Banabhatta and from Mallinatha and a host of others. I'll cite only one from Mallinatha. He says, Kalidasa Giram Saram, Kalidasa Saraswati, Chaturmukho Athava Saksha, Vidur Nanyetu Madrashaha. The essence of Kalidasa's words, only three can understand. That is Kalidasa himself, and Saraswati, the goddess of speech, and Brahma, so the husband of Saraswati. So only these three people can know, and not one like me. He says he is the commentator on all the kavyas of Kalidasa. So now this is not like the case of the joke. So where in an interview a person was asked this question, I have only one small question for you. What is electricity? So the fellow said, sir, I know it, but I'm not remembering the definition of electricity. And the interviewer seems to have said, what a tragedy. Only two persons in the world know what is electricity truly. One is God, who is not available, and the other is yourself, and you have forgotten. What a tragedy. It is not in that sense that it has been said by Mallinatha like this, but the greater the depths that one can fathom in Kalidasa's poetry, so you can find greater charm, so and greater depths of meaning, and it is not very easy. So that way, even Mallinatha, I'll show you subsequently, has not really delved so very deep into Kalidasa as would be possible. So I'll show you a few occasions. So the great rhetorician Anandavardhana says, there are only five or six Mahakavis. So even though there are thousands of great poets, and the study of one work called Shakuntala of Kalidasa made Gayate remark. So he exclaimed, so he wrote a poem in German which has been translated into English by Eastwick. He says, wouldst thou the young year's blossoms and the fruits of its decline, and all by which the soul is charmed, enraptured, feasted, fed, wouldst thou the earth and heaven itself in one sole name combine, I name thee, O Shakuntala, and all at once is said. So these are the words of exclamation by Gayate, the great poet. And Arthur Ryder, so who was in the University of California, says, no other poet in any land has sung of the happy love between man and woman in the same large way as Kalidasa has sung. So there are hundreds of scholars who have praised Kalidasa. I have chosen only one. And one of the best way of giving compliments to a person is by emulating him. already in the second and third century AD, in between that, the Chinese poet Su Kan, he has written a poem in which he sends a message to his wife through a cloud, as Kalidasa already done. And he says, "O floating clouds that swim in heaven above, bear on your wings these words to him I love." So she's a lady sending a message to her lover. So similarly, the German poet Friedrich Schiller, he wrote a play called Maria Stuart. So this was in the 18th century. So he is a leading German dramatist, a poet, and a literary theorist. And he also makes use of this idea of sending a message to the beloved through the clouds. So, and there is one translation of Meghaduta by H.H. Wilson, and where the Yaksha begins to describe the route to the cloud. So he makes this remark. This is Wilson's remark: "We now begin the geographical part of the poem, which, as far as it can be made out through the difference of ancient and modern appellations, modern names, seems to be very accurately conceived." So, and I conclude this portion with one word of appreciation by K.S. Ramaswamy Shastri, who says, "Asia is the heart of the world, India is the heart of Asia, and Kalidasa is the heart of India. If India's need of Kalidasa is great, the need of Kalidasa by the rest of the wide, wide world is even greater." It's for this reason that we are looking into the poetry of Kalidasa, and starting with Kumarasambhavam. So we start with the first verse of Kumarasambhavam.
हस्त्युत्तरस्यां दिशि देवतात्मा हिमालयो नाम नगाधिराजः उत्तरस्यां दिशि देवतात्मा हिमालयो नाम नगाधिराजः पूर्वापरौ तोयनिधि वगाह्य स्थितः पृथिव्या इव मानदण्डः पूर्वापरौ तोयनिधि वगाह्य स्थितः पृथिव्या इव मानदण्डः।
Kalidasa starts with the description of the wonderful Himalayas. India has been defined as Uttaram yat samudrasya himadreshchaiva dakshinam varsham tad bharatam nama bharati yatra santatih. So he goes to the very peaks of the Himalayas and starts the description. So in the right, in the northern direction, Uttarasyam Dishi, this divine being, Devatatma Himalayaha, the king of mountains, Nagadhirajaha, and the expanse of the mountain is such, apart from its height, the expanse of the mountain is such that it dips its feet into the eastern and western oceans, Purvaparau Toyanidhi Vagahya, and it is also the measuring rod of the universe, of the earth, Prithivyaha Manadandaha Iva. Manadanda is the measuring rod. Ramaswamy Shastri says that indeed Indian culture is the measuring rod of the other cultures of the world. So because much beyond what we get by our sensory information, this culture has delved deep into the very spiritual depths, and this is indeed a measuring rod. So he starts with the description of the Himalaya. There are some 17 verses of description, so I will not be able to go into all that. Today it will be a brief picture and an overview, introduction and overview of this entire work. So you will know, in spite of it being a ये फेस्टिविटी डे ऑफ फेस्टिविटी टुडे सो मेनी ऑफ यू हैव बीन एबल टू कम सो यू विल बी सर्टनली बेनिफिटिंग फ्रॉम द अदर लेक्चर्स वेयर वी विल बी एबल टू गो डीपर इनटू मेनी ऑफ द वर्सेस नाउ दिस हिमालय मैरिड मेना सो हु वॉज हरसेल्फ रिवियर्ड बाय ऋषिस एंड दे हैड ए सन बाय नेम मैनाका एंड ए डॉटर बाय नेम पार्वती In fact, the word Parvati is a derivation from Parvata. So it's a patronymic, as it is called, derived from a father's name. So the beauty of Parvati is described in some 20 verses. And even while she was young, once Narada made a visit to Himalaya and said, Your daughter is extraordinary. She is destined to marry Shiva and therefore don't think of any other groom for her. And therefore, even though there are many other suitors for her, so seeking her hand, so Himavan did not think of any other person. And Shiva himself was doing tapas in the Himalayan regions, and Himavan thought that she must go and serve Lord Shiva, who is performing tapas, and Parvati goes there and serves him. Actually, there is a story behind this. Parvati was actually already Shiva's wife, so she was the daughter of Daksha. She was called Dakshayani, and her father Daksha insulted Shiva, and once he performed a sacrifice, he invited every god except Shiva, and Dakshayani felt very offended, and still she went there in spite of the obstruction by Shiva, advice by Shiva against that. And she was humiliated there, and therefore she felt very bad, and therefore she burnt her body through Yogagni and with the resolve, sankalpa, that she should be born again, destined to be the wife of Shiva, but bereft of humiliations such as these. And she was she who was born as the daughter of Parvata or Himalaya. And Shiva, while he was doing tapas, so after the death of Dakshayani, Shiva grew even more serious and would not allow women near him. So he went to a secluded place. But when Parvati came and served, so he was happy to allow her to serve. And Kalidasa on that occasion says that men who have attained a high state of spiritual attainment would not be swayed by distractions. Vikara hetau sati vikriyante yesham na chetam sita eva dhiraha. He gives a definition of a dhira there. And while this was happening, the various gods go to Brahma with a request. Namely, that there is a demon by name Taraka who was oppressing all the gods. So this is one typical theme of all the Puranas. So there is a certain asura who performs tapas, and God in his wisdom or unwisdom grants them boons, and the asura becomes very powerful and becomes a tyrant and very oppressive, and then the gods go see and request either Brahma or Vishnu or Maheshwara, and he says, okay, I'll come down, and so he takes an avatara and ultimately comes and destroys that demon. Now the various asuras, they were all very intelligent. They were all, you see, of very firm resolve, and they would perform very long tapas, and they would ask for boons which shows that they were very smart. Okay, so one asura asked for a boon wherein he said, upon whosoever head I lay my hand, he should be reduced to ashes. You know the story of Bhasmasura, and he chased the very god who granted that boon, and Shiva, who granted the boon, could easily have destroyed Bhasmasura all by himself, but he wants to conform to his own rules, and therefore he pretends running away, so being afraid of Bhasmasura who is chasing him, and then he sends an SMS or SOS to Vishnu, who says, I will come and save you, help you, no problem. The divinity knows the strong weakness of this asura. So there will be some kind of weakness or the other. So making use of that, the asura will be trapped. So this asura had not conquered Kama, and therefore Vishnu came as Mohini, and therefore he forgot his chase of Shiva and got drawn towards this Mohini. And this Mohini, so also she tried to teach him a lesson that he was going astray and he could use his wonderful power for the good of himself and good, the good of others, but no, he won't listen. So she made him to dance. So she said, it's only a dancer that I can marry, and if you can dance like me, I will marry you. So, and so she began to perform the dance, and he was, you see, imitating that, and she kept her own hand on her own head, and Bhasmasura was finished. You all know the story. You all know the story of Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu, and so on. So everywhere they have asked for very smart boons. First they ask for freedom from death. So God says it is not possible. And then they will think of some next best solution. And it is these kinds of solutions that they think of. So it works for some time, but afterwards it has to have its own end. Similarly, this Tarakasura in Kumarasambhava had asked for one boon. Namely, that he should not be killed by anybody except a 7-day-old child. Now, which 7-day-old child can come and think asura? Such a powerful asura whom even gods are afraid of. So, after this fellow has become a great tormentor of the world, so gods all go to Brahma and they praise Brahma and they make a request to him. So, in their words of praise, they say that, O Lord, you are the Trimurti. Brahma himself is, actually, Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwara are not different at all. All the three are but one principle showing itself in three aspects. So they say, Namastrimurtaye tubhyam praksrishte kevalatmane gunatraya vibhagaya paschat bhedam upeyushe. So Kalidasa was very thorough in knowledge of the theories of Sankhya and Yoga. And he says that, it's when the Supreme Brahman, which is Kevalatman at the outset, so assumes the three gunas that he becomes the Trimurtis. And it's only in the field of Trimurtis that these asuras also function. And it is in these one of these aspects that he has to come and destroy the asuras. Namas Trimurtaye Tubhyam is one of the famous praises of Brahma in Kalidasa's work.
त्रिमूर्तये तुभ्यं प्राक् सृष्टेः केवलात्मने त्रिमूर्तये नमस्तुभ्यं प्राक् सृष्टेः केवलात्मने गुणत्रय विभागाय पश्चात् भेदमुपेयुषे त्रिमूर्तये तुभ्यं नमः प्राक् सृष्टेः केवलात्मने गुणत्रय विभागाय पश्चात् भेदमुपेयुषे गुणत्रय विभागाय पश्चात् भेदमुपेयुषे भेदमुपेयुषे.
And when the various gods so tell Brahma how they are oppressed by Tarakasura, he gives a solution. He says, the one person who can be the father of a child who can slay this asura is Lord Shiva, who is doing tapas in the Himalaya, and Parvati is serving him. And if Shiva marries Parvati, then surely the child that will be born of them would kill this Tarakasura. And if you can somehow ensure that Shiva marries Parvati, your job is done. So Indra decides to do this, and so he summons Manmatha, Kama. So he says, here is a great task of the divinities. So can you do this? And Manmatha says, well, I can sway the mind of any sage, including Shiva. And he says, he takes as his companion Madhu, the spring. And the two go to the place where Shiva was performing tapas. And suddenly, out of season, it is the spring season suddenly, and there is enjoyment all around, a mood of enjoyment all around. And Manmatha comes and sees Lord Shiva. But when he sees Shiva absorbed in his tapas, he literally shivers in his shoes, because he had never seen a person absorbed in tapas in such a serious manner. And he thinks that his mission will be a failure. But just then there arrives Parvati, who is the paragon of beauty. And seeing her as the very embodiment of beauty, he thinks that he now can see attempt and to disturb the mind and distract the mind of Shiva and make it drawn towards Parvati. And therefore, he chooses the Sammohanastra, the mesmerizer, to his bow and aims at Lord Shiva. And at that very moment, Shiva feels a disturbance for a fraction of a moment. And that was the very moment when Parvati was making an offer of flowers to him. And he looks at Parvati's face, and he also realizes at once that his mind functioned in a manner that it should not have. And the moment he realizes that there was some disturbance and this straying of the mind, he looks around looking for the cause, and he sees Manmatha so fixing the arrow to his bow, and he becomes very angry. Tapah paramarsha vivriddhamanyor bhubhanga duspreksha mukhasya tasya sphuran udarchi sahasa tritiya dakshana krishanuh kila nishpapata. So then from the third eye of Shiva came this fire, so which came towards Manmatha. And the gods assembled there, who were all waiting for Manmatha to succeed and wishing him success, they were all disappointed, because they all prayed, O Lord, withhold your anger. Manmatha has come to do one of the tasks of the divinities. So he say, they say, Krodham Prabho Samhara Samhareti Yavad Girakhe Marutam Charanti Tavat Savanhir Bhavanetra Janma Bhasma Vashesham Madanam Chakara. So,
क्रोधं प्रभो संहर संहरेति प्रभो क्रोधं संहर संहरेति यावद् गिरहखे मरुतां चरन्ति तावत् सवन्हिः भवनेत्र जन्मा भस्मावशेषं मदनं चकार प्रभो क्रोधं संहर संहरेति यावद् गिरः खे मरुतां चरन्ति तावत् सवन्हिः भवनेत्र जन्मा भस्मावशेषं मदनं चकार.
So before the words of the various divinities reached Lord Shiva, Manmatha had been reduced to ashes. So, while teaching this verse in the class, I once remarked, because the class consisted of students of science, I said, after all, light is faster than sound. So, by the time the words of the various divinities could reach Shiva, he had already burnt Manmatha to ashes. And along with Manmatha had come his wife Rati and Madhu the spring. And Rati was so full of sorrow now that her husband had died. And Kalidasa describes, this Karuna Rasa in a very beautiful manner, in a very heart-touching manner. And Rati, who so deeply loved Manmatha, could no more bear to live. And she thinks of committing an end to putting an end to her life, so committing suicide and ending her life doing sahagamana. She says, Shashina sahayati kaumudi sahameghena tadit priliyate pramada pativartmaga iti pratipannam hi vichetanairapi. There is the beautiful exploitation of even the gender of words in Sanskrit here. So she says, the moonlight goes away along with the disappearance of the moon. So the word for moonlight, kaumudi, is in strilinga. And the word for moon in Sanskrit is in pullinga, shashi. So, shashina sahayati kaumudi, sahameghena tadit praliyate. So, tadit is the lightning. The word for that in Sanskrit is in feminine gender. And megha is the cloud, which is in masculine. So, with the disappearance of the cloud, no more can lightning be seen. So, pramada pativartmaga iti pratipannam hi vichetanairapi. So, it's as though even the nature holds out a lesson for women that women cannot afford to continue to live in the absence of their husband. And therefore, I no more like to live. And so, she thinks of ending her life. So, but then there arises an asharīravāṇī, a divine voice which says, Rati, do not end your life. Manmatha will be revived. That will happen when Shiva marries Parvati, and therefore don't end your life. So she holds on to life, but the fate of Parvati is even more disappointing, because she thought that because she was endowed with exquisite beauty, she can entice the heart of Shiva. But now it was a very cruel lesson for her that it is impossible for mere physical beauty to draw the mind of Shiva. And therefore, Parvati decides to perform tapas. So, the poet describes the tapas of Parvati in a very excellent manner. Two episodes of tapas, one of Shiva himself and another of Parvati, in the third canto and in the fifth canto, that exquisite descriptions, at once poetic, at once spiritual. So they are. So, I'll be dwelling on those things in greater detail when I come to those portions. So, and there is one verse in the fifth canto of Kumarasambhavam of the performance of tapas of Parvati. So, where she does what is called Panchagni tapas. So, four fires around her during summer and gazing at the sun as the fifth fire. This is called Panchagni tapas. And in the winter season, she immersed neck deep in the cold waters. So, in the Himalayan region, and she performs tapas then. And after the passing of the summer season, at the commencement of the rainy season, when she is absorbed in tapas, the first rain drops come. Kalidasa gives a description of the course of the first rain drops. He says, those first rain drops, sthitaha kshanam pakshmasu. They stayed for a while, lingered for a while on her eyelashes. So her eyelashes were so beautiful. He describes her eyelashes so very well. So they were so thick and curved that they lingered there for a while. Sitaha kshanam pakshmasu taditadharaha. And then they hit her lower lip. So the lip is the most delicate organ, and therefore they must have formed a depression when they hit her lower lip. Taditadharaha payodharotseda nipata churnitaha. When they fell on their breasts, so her lofty breasts, they were shattered. And then valishatasyas khalita prapede, and on her stomach there were three lines, okay, the three horizontal lines, the folds there. So it's also considered a mark of saubhagya. So three lines on the forehead, three lines on the throat, and three lines on the abdomen, they are considered as maha saubhagya suchaka, and they are marks of beauty. And there they only stumbled and proceeded slowly, and finally they reached her nabhi or navel. So this looks like just a physical description, this is also a yogic description of a person totally absorbed in the state of samadhi, and where his body is straight and still. And actually speaking, when the first drops of rain come, anybody would be drawn towards the sweet fragrance of the earth that emits with the same. Okay, that could be a distraction for tapas. So, because the sense organs which are drawn inwards would be drawn outwards, and then the pouring of or the sprinkling of water on any person who is in a state of sleep or in a state of swoon or in a state of even see absorption within in a state of meditation can immediately make his mind turn outwards. But nothing of that sort happened with Parvati. So she was so still and so impervious to what was happening to her outside.
Sthitahakshanam pakshmasu taaditadharah payodharot sedanipata churnitah sthitahakshanam pakshmasu taaditadharah payodharot sedanipata churnitah वलीषु तस्यास्खलिताः प्रपेदिरे चिरेण नाभिं प्रथमोदबिन्दवः वलीषु तस्यास्खलिताः प्रपेदिरे चिरेण नाभिं प्रथमोदबिन्दवः.
And while she was so deeply absorbed in tapas, Shiva actually becomes very happy. so that, see, even the slight sense of ego on account of the consciousness of her own beauty is all now done away with. And because she has become even the more pure now, so Shiva himself arrives there. And he befriends her and asks her what is the goal of her tapas is. And he says that he has himself amassed a lot of tapas in his brahmachari ashrama, and so he has come disguised as a brahmacharin, and he says that he has amassed a lot of tapas and he can grant her half of it and she can achieve what she wants to attain, provided she is able to tell what is the reason for tapas. So Parvati asks her friend to indicate that, and she says that she wants to marry Shiva. And this brahmacharin, who is Shiva himself in disguise, begins to abuse Shiva and says that what kind of a fool you are that you are trying to marry Shiva. He lives in the cemetery, he has nothing to wear, he is utterly poor, and so on and so forth. He begins to deride Shiva and criticize Shiva and criticize her goals and objectives. And Parvati gives her reply to every one of the objections he raises against Shiva. This is only to show that even when you are deeply absorbed in our religious pursuits, you must know what we are doing and why we are doing. So, you know, to bring this home, Kalidasa creates this situation and Parvati defends her cause so very well. And the brahmacharan seems to be interested in speaking a little more, and Parvati notices that and she decides to quit that place. So rather than turning away a guest, and just then when she is angrily leaving that place, Shiva shows himself in his true form and holds her by the hand. And Parvati is in a state of utter confusion. She was full of anger for him. She was so full. Now she suddenly, by the sudden situation, she is surprised and almost shocked. And this is a very pleasant shock. And she doesn't know whether she should stand there or move out. So he says, Kalidasa says, Shailadhiraja tanaya nayayau natasthau. She could neither stand there nor move away from there. And he gives a very beautiful comparison. See, just to enjoy the kind of the upamas and see comparisons that Kalidasa gives, you must attend these lectures. So, and Shiva says, Adya prabhrityavanatangi tavasmidasaha. So henceforth I am your slave. Because slaves could be purchased those days, and he says, you have purchased me by giving the price, namely tapas. Adya prabhritya vanatangi tavas midasaha kritas tapo bhiriti vadini chandramaulau anhaisa niyamajam klamamutsa sarja kleshav phale nahi punar navatam vidhatte. So suddenly all the exhaustion and fatigue that she felt on account of the long tapas all vanishes. So we'll be finishing in another 5 to 10 minutes. So. And then now that Shiva has expressed his willingness to marry her. So Parvati says, well, we must follow the proper procedure. So please send some persons for the negotiation to my father, and so it should come through the right channel. And Shiva thinks of the Saptarshis, and the seven sages come there. The seven sages along with Arundhati have come there. And Kalidasa says that Shiva received them all in an equal manner. So Arundhati is a woman, and for no reason was she treated in any manner different from the seven sages. Kalidasa says, Tam agaurava bhedena munims chapashyadishwaraha stri pumanityanasthaisha vrittam mahitam satam. So great men do not differentiate that it is a man or a woman and so on. So he treated her equally. Okay. And then Himavan is only very, so the Saptarshis go to her father Himavan and plead for giving away in marriage Parvati to Shiva, and they are more than happy. And they fix the marriage date also, and it is just 3 days away. So, and for Shiva himself, Kalidasa says, those 3 days were very difficult to pass. So a touch of human element, you see, so that is given to all the divinities in our, see, Puranas. So he says, Pushupatirapitan, Nyahani Krichra, Dagamaya Dadrisuta, Samaga Motkaha, Kamaparam Avasham, Naviprakuryur, Vibhumapitam, Yadami, Prashanti Bhavaha. If even the Vibhu, even if the Lord is himself touched by these emotions, then no wonder, see, human beings are touched by such emotions.
Pashupatirapitanyahani krichrat agamayat adrisuta samagamotkaha Pashupatirapitanyahani krichrat agamayat adrisuta samagamotkaha Kamaparam avasham na viprakuryoho Vibhumapitam yadami sprishanti bhavaha Kamaparam avasham na viprakuryoho ami bhavaha Vibhum apitam yadami sprishanti bhavah.
And so after the actual marriage of Shiva and Parvati takes place, and that marriage is also described in a very beautiful manner. So the attention to detail of these many things, even simple things, Kalidasa pays attention to. He's such a close observation of nature and close observation of life, you can rarely get in other poems. So, in the context of the Parvati, Vishnu was present and Brahma was present, and in that context, Kalidasa makes this remark, actually, all the three are but one. So, it is the single unit that shows itself in three aspects. Ekaiva murtir bibhide tridha sa. So it is one Parabrahman that shows himself as Brahma, as Vishnu, and as Shiva, depending upon their different roles. And he says, see, the common man is puzzled by the portrayal in the Puranas. In some Puranas, Shiva is portrayed as the greatest god. In some Puranas, Vishnu is portrayed as the highest god. Okay? There is actually no contradiction between these, because it is quite common that samanya mesham prathama varatvam. So one's superiority and inferiority, these are common to all the three gods. So Vishnur haraha tasya harih kadachit vedhastayo stavapi dhatu radyau. Sometimes Vishnu is supreme and the other two are subordinate to him, and sometimes, see, Brahma is supreme, and sometimes Shiva is supreme, and the other two are subordinate to him, and so on. So it is something like my teacher, Ranga, who became a sannyasin later by name Rangapriya Swamiji, who gave this example. See, among equal scholars sometimes, see, one Mr. A will be the chairman and B will be the speaker in some other function. So B will be the chairman and A will be the speaker and so on. So it doesn't mean that, so just because in one particular function so and so is made the chairman, it does not mean the others are inferior. So they are of an equal rank. And so the three murtis are actually but one in essence.
एकैव मूर्तिर्बिभिदे त्रिधा सा सामान्यमेषां प्रथमावरत्वं विष्णोर्हरः तस्य हरिः कदाचित् वेधास्तयोः तावपि धातुराद्यौ विष्णोर्हरः तस्य हरिः कदाचित् वेधास्तयोः तावपि धातुराद्यौ.
In the next sargas, there is a description of the dalliance between Shiva and Parvati. And finally, see, the child that is born, namely Subramanya, he slays Taraka. So with this ends Kumara Sambhava. So I have given a brief skeletal picture of this kavya. And in the subsequent lectures, we will go almost sarga by sarga. There are numerous episodes and in fact, even single shlokas, the nuances of which are very extraordinary and very enjoyable. So we will reserve the details into our next lectures. Thank you for coming for this lecture. Thank you. Namaskar.
Yeah. So one question and one suggestion. Question is, you said that Kalidasa expresses things much more simply than other words. Can you use some examples to illustrate that? Some example of a description.
Language of Kalidasa being simpler than language of other poets.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So some example, actual examples.
Actual examples.
Actual examples. I will give in the next lectures. take for example the language of Bharavi or language of Magha. Okay, you require commentaries to understand them. Of course, even to understand Kalidasa fully require commentaries because there is so much of depth of meaning. So, but in the case of others, they show off their knowledge of vocabulary, their command over language and so on. So as a consequence, so you see that is an age of competition. So it depends upon which kind of competition that you have. So here they wanted to show off their thorough command over the vocabulary. Sanskrit has a very vast vocabulary. So that being the case, the command over the language, see, it's enjoyable by itself. But in Kalidasa, it's a very simple language. So that I will show in subsequent lectures. So while I deal with ideas, I can bring in some parallel idea from some other poet and show how.
Another thing was, so when she is reciting, does her explanation follow her recital or does her recital follow your explanation?
Mm-hmm. Normally, the recital follows the explanation so that it does.
Once I have explained the idea, you will be able to relish the singing the more. See, for example, the first showers of the rain. So she chose the raga Amrita Varshini. So that stands for the Amrita Varsha. So the shower of Amrita. Okay, there is a significance for her, the way she repeats some of the words there in the shloka also. So to bring out the idea, therefore I will be explaining the idea first and then she will be singing. That will be the answer.
One question.
Yes, please.
Can you search the print edition of Kumara Sambhava where the Sanskrit is very well and legibly printed?
Very well and legibly printed Sanskrit.
You can find if you go to archive.org, okay, you get scanned copies of Kalidasa's Kumara Sambhava by M.R. Kale. Okay, you can get there. You can get very legibly printed this one. Scanned copy you can have. So, Motilal Banarsidas has published this this book. It is available in print also. So, if you go to Motilal Banas, I think in Mylapore you have this Motilal Banarsidas. So, you can get from there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. With English translation you have. So that and one Sanskrit commentary also. Yes, please.
Kalidasa describes in great detail the marriage and also to some extent the married life of Shiva and Parvati. But not in much detail, birth of Kumar, actual Kumar Sambhava.
Yeah, yeah. You see, there is a controversy there. It is said that, so this Kumar Sambhava has 17 cantos. And it is said that only 8 cantos are written by him. Mallinatha has commented upon only 8 cantos. I did not go into all those details today because this is only a very introductory lecture. And it is said that there is what is called dhvani maryada in Sanskrit. So, the power of suggestion. Sometimes we leave something unsaid, and many times good jokes will have their strong effect because something was left unsaid. Okay, I'll give you one example of Einstein. He says, two things are said to be infinite. One is the expanse of the universe, and the other is the stupidity of the human mind. Okay, so there is another one which he says,
And
he says, I'm not sure about the former. Okay. Yeah, thank you. there is another statement of Einstein. He says, I do not know how the third world war would be fought, but the fourth world war would be fought with sticks and stones. So, which means to say the third world war will destroy all civilization. So, it's precisely because it is left unsaid, it becomes, you see, more charming and more effective. So, that way, Kalidasa has, you see, described the marriage of Parvati and Shiva, and that the offspring born of them is bound to achieve its goal. So, though it is only merely hinted, so Sahrdayas can catch that hint. So, but it is said, but we do get the other sargas. So, 17 sargas we have, and Mallinatha has commented only up to 8. And it is said that they are by a different hand, but sometimes there are also very beautiful verses even in those sargas. So, it is not very clear whether it was written by Kalidasa or not. There are some doubts, okay. But on the whole, it is a very charming poem.